you thought you'd get away with it, huh? All right. Hey, you know, I personally think we pussyfoot a lot. You know what is it, pussyfooting, don't you? You know what pussyfooting is. I mean, we're a nation of good guys. We don't really say what we really think, you know. No way. It's very hard for anybody to say what he thinks. How many times have you gone over to some friend's house, you know, and you're sitting there, and he starts telling you a long, boring story? Now, what is your first thought, you know? Say, well, what is it? What's with the long, boring story? Cut it out, Stanley. That's boring. And then he shows you his pictures, which make the story look like Moby Dick. If there's anything more boring than looking at a friend's picture, I would like to, any kind of picture, I would like to know what it is, unless it's his wife, streaking across the yard or something like that. But usually, if I see one more set of pictures about somebody's kids, I'm going to do what Dorothy Parker always said she was threatening to do when somebody told her about Winnie the Pooh. I'm going to throw up. And I'm going to tell you, pretty honestly, Shepherd makes W.C. Fields look like a social worker in charge of seven-year-olds. I'm telling you this. You know what I do with kids? You know what I use them? You can see Shepherd isn't burdened with his own. You know what I do with a kid? I'll tell you what I use on them. Fly swatters. Boy, it's very effective. Get out of here! Bam! There, I got him. Look at that little... Get out of here. Stick out. Oh, there's another one. Okay. Would you hit the money button, please, quick, before they come to be below me. Snuck up on.
There's fashion every day and happening round your way. It's how you live. It's happy and be glory.
It's a great day for a great summer fashion sale. And it's happening right now at all 15 B&B Laurie's fashion centers. Jeffrey Beam, Eagle, British Dax, Pierre Cardin, 3G, the who's who in men's fashion, join in making a spectacular fashion event out of a savings event. A sale where you'll find dramatic reductions on top quality men's suits, sport coats, slacks, ensembles, and Bostonian shoes. In every department, the best fashion and the best values. And charging is as easy as saving money. Now, during B&B Laurie's great summer fashion sale at all 15 B&B Laurie's in Greater New York, never has so great a fashion and savings event been so convenient.
Come to B&B Laurie's. Come to B&B Laurie's.
Also available at Tress Green Acres, Zimmerman's Rutherford, New Jersey, Scott Barry, Mount Kisco.
Yes. Very loud man. Well, you know, have to shout to get out sometimes. You know, I don't want to offend anybody there who's a kid kook, and there are many of those. This is the first nation, I think, in the history of the world, Jim, that could be honestly called a juvenocracy. Yes, it is. It's a juvenocracy. Earlier societies were patriarchies. Old patriarchal society like that. Victorian England was a patriarchy.
Really?
There have been matriarchies. We had a matriarchy in this country till recently. Yeah, we were a matriarchal country. Oh, yeah, almost everything was aimed at the housewife. Oh, yeah, you know, she was... a matriarchy, now we're talking about a true matriarchy. We're not talking about who governs. That's not... that's nothing. Governing is not where the real power is. No way. Nixon found it out. But seriously, the matriarchy, we used to have a matriarchy. You remember Philip Wiley writing all that stuff? There was a famous book about it called A Generation of Vipers. You don't know about that book. Well, you stick around, you're going to learn all about books. But I'm amazed at how many people don't know much about what was written before yesterday afternoon's Post. And even then, they're a little weak on that. You know, if you ask them closely, you notice that they move their lips when they read the racing form. And, I'm sorry, Dave, I wasn't referring to you, but reading they're the talented, and then there's the others, and some can't. So, nevertheless, I must say that this is a juvenocracy. Practically every family I know, the entire world revolves around these three little toads Now, in the very real sense, I know guys. I know one guy. The other day, I meet him next to the water cooler. See, and I said, "What's the matter, Bob?" And he looks thin and pale, and he said, "Oh, God, oh, it's just traveling." I said, what do you mean traveling? What do? You been on a vacation or something? No. I said, you know, it's 2 hours up to Connecticut. In the morning, 2 hours back, 2 hours, 4 hours a day I travel on the train. I said, well, why do you do this, Bob? Well, it's Madge, you know. She says, it's a nice place to raise the kids. I said, yeah, but it's a hell of a rotten place to raise you. Look at you. I said, you're going down the drain here, man. You look 107 years old, and I know you're not over a day over maybe 95. Look at you.
Yeah, but, you know, the kids, the kids.
I said, what the hell, kids? What do you mean, the kids?
Oh, it's good, you know, they got a good school out there.
I said, good school? What do you mean, a good school? Well, you told me yourself that little Stanley can't read, and he's 17. Little Stanley, 17, little Stanley. Hey, what do you call little? That lunk is 6'9", weighs 270 pounds. He eats nothing but Fig Newtons and drinks Ripple wine. And you tell me he's little Stanley? Are you kidding? Well, he's little Stanley to me. I said, bull, little Stanley. Little Stanley's hanging around the pool room every night, and you're working away. And I this is how many guys live this way, you know? They really do. That's a juvenocracy, man. You better believe it. That's right. In a very real sense. I know one guy who was before he was married, this guy's about 19, 20 years old. He's all part of the juvenocracy scene, see? And I said, one night, we go out to this place, see, and we're going to have dinner, a couple of us, you know, a bunch of guys hanging around, bucks, you know, we go into this place. And he says, no, he said, I don't know. He said, I better pass, fellas. It's a little steep for my blood. And he got paid like everybody else, you know. And I said, what do you mean? Howie, what are you talking about? Oh, Steve, what the heck? You only live once. Come on. Heaven's sakes, let's go down there. In fact, I'm going to have two big boys. I mean, hell, I just figure you can't take it with you. And I may even have some fresh fries on the side. And I'll have a chocolate mocha malt. What the hell? Life is short. He said, I don't know what I said. I'm going to go home and eat some cornflakes. And I said, what for? What are you saving for? What are you doing? He said, well, you know, I'm saving for my kids' college. I said, you're doing what? I didn't know you had. Hey, fellas, Howie's saving for his kids. Howie wasn't married. Howie's got kids. He said, no, wait a minute, fellas. Look, fellas, now wait a minute. You got to plan ahead. No. I want to plan ahead. And when I get married, I want to have kids right away. And then I want to make sure that I have enough money in the bank at that time for the pay their way through college. Then me and the wife won't have to worry about that. And then we'll have all the rest of our life to live the way we want to live it. When the kids are out of school, I says, Howie, wait a minute. You haven't even met a girl yet you want to marry, have you? Well, no. He said, but I know it's going to happen one time. After all, that's what life's about, getting married and having kids and sending them to college, right? I said, no, Howie. That ain't what life is about. It's what life in the United States is about. He said, what do you mean? What are you talking about? I said, Howie, this is the only place in the world where people live their entire lives for this kid named, this lout named Clifford, who hangs around down in the basement and smokes pot. I mean, this is the only place in the world they do that. He said, oh, come on. What do you mean? You mean it's the only place in the world they have kids? I said, no, it's not the only place in the world where they have kids. But it's the only place in the world where your life is built on having kids. The only place in the world. I mean, they don't do this. It's unknown, totally unknown, for a Frenchman to live in a house only because the kids like it. Why, the back of my head, mon Dieu, caramba! You know, that's what he would say in Spanish. You try that in Hungary. He says, I ain't him put him, touch you. And he give him a shot in the back of the neck. At Pakrika. The kid goes out and has to eat his chicken by himself in the doghouse. No way. Only in America, right? Which shows, of course, we're a far more civilized nation. Now, of course, this always has bothered me. It has a kind of mirror quality to it. In other words, have you ever seen the Dutch cleanser? Can of Dutch cleanser, kitchen cleanser. You know what that is? You know what the picture is in the Dutch cleanser? What is it? It is not a little chicken. That's Bon Ami. Good friend. Bon Ami. And what is it they say on the Bon Ami can? Has not ever scratched yet. Right. You're good Americans. You know all the slogans. Right. What was the slogan of the Packard? ask the man who owns one, and that did him in. Do you know that that did them in? Too many people did. There ain't no car dealer that would have the guts to have a slogan like that today. I mean, ask the man who owns one. He's liable to hit you in the mouth. The average car, you know, with the Reynolds wrap hood and the silly putty differential and all the rest of it, gets 3 miles to the gas gallon downhill with a key off. And you ask him, how do you like it, Fred? Well, that's beside the point. What is on the Dutch cleanser? Quick. Quickie more. And while you're considering that, hit him with another commercial, please, Jim. Please. Fast track. That's it. That's it. One long scream of joy. One long scream of joy. Well, you hear the copy on this one.
Godspell. The world's most popular musical is now in its fourth record-breaking year at the Promenade Theater, 76th Street and Broadway. Time magazine called Godspell a theatrical miracle, and audiences all over the world have thrilled to its music. One long, sweet cry of joy, says John Simon of New York Magazine. Don't miss Godspell. And if you've seen it, it's even better the second time around. Godspell at the Promenade Theater, 76th Street and Broadway.
Oh, 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 very good, very good. This is WOR New York, speaking of one long screams of joy. Well, I'll tell you a little more about that, though. What is it? Come on. What is it? I'm very serious about this, that I've often wondered, at what point do most people decide they're going to start living their own lives? I think it's an important point. I think some people never do. Do you agree with that, Jim? And what beer tells you that there's only one time around? The implication, of course, of that beer spot is get bombed. Forget it. Have you noticed that there's a curious fatalism beginning to creep in the commercials? There's one airline that tells you might as well make it now because... And, you know, one guy implies that you may not last till next year. You know that one. Did you see that one? Then there's another one. There's another guy that says in the same commercial, he says, you might as well go to Europe now. Of course, you can't afford it. It's terrible expensive. It's unbelievably expensive. But it's going to be more next year. It's going to be rotten next year. So you might as well do it now. You seen that one? That's fatalism, man. And, you know, you find that all over. Now, the question here... I think most people in this country are feeling dissatisfied with their lives for a lot of reasons, and I think one of the reasons is that they devote their lives too often to living other people's lives too early in their life. Now, this is just a suggestion from, you know, a living human being just like anybody else, and this is purely a personal. It does not represent the news department here. It does not represent, John Chancellor's views or anything else. This is just, you know... just me, but I can tell you this, that I think I'm as much an expert on life as anybody who ever lived it. Now, that doesn't sound egotistical, it only is true, because nobody's an expert on life, Jim. We like to think there are guys that are, you know, they write this book, How to Get More Out of Living. And that makes him more of an expert. See, I'm living, it's just like this guy the other day, you know, the one that wrote a book on how you can make all this money on the market. Bestseller for about 17 consecutive weeks. He was the guy, one of the guys, that was caught in this big flim-flam down in Wall Street. You remember that? He lost about 200 grand. Expert, schmexpert. I know a guy who wrote a best-selling book on marital relations. Married four times. And at the time that his book was out, his fifth wife was in the process of leaving him after shooting twice at him with a .22 caliber Colt Woodsman. Nice gun, too, by the way. Very nice. She showed good taste. Unfortunately, she was a rotten shot. That's right. Hit the TV set in the refrigerator. But that didn't stop him from writing a book on how to keep your marriage singing, how to keep it moving there, friends.
And there's only one thing that makes the world move, really. Money. Hit the money button, please.
You can see them on Malibu mornings and Oahu afternoons, paddling silently out on their boards in search of that perfect wave. And every great once in a while, the sea will give up a perfectly great 15-foot monster. And if you're there, and if you're very good and very lucky, you might find yourself tucked tight inside a blue cathedral doing 30 miles an hour and yelling your head off with joy. And after a ride like that, you've got to share that kind of moment with good friends over a great glass of beer.
If you've got the time, we got the beer, Miller beer. Miller tasty, to hurry through.
That's what Miller time is all about. Taking time to appreciate the best tasting beer you can find. Miller High Life, America's quality beer since 1855.
Miller beer.
Oh, no, nobody's excluded from life. You're correct. No, I can see the Pope waking up some morning, you know, and sitting there, and he's putting on all this stuff, and all of a sudden he says, how the devil did I get involved in all this? What is this? but this has to be, you know, it's the course of the human mind. It's the way it is. It is a questioning thing. And, rightfully so. And I just feel, though, that like the other night. Now, this is the kind of stuff that really, really makes you wonder, you know. And once in a while, I make a foray into suburbia. And it's always very, very enlightening to me that the suburbia types are very different from walking around people. Suburbanites have a whole different set of values. Very interesting set of values. First of all, it's based largely on, among other things, you can't just say material things. It's based largely on real estate, on the house, you know, the house in capital letters. I wonder how many guys' lives, people, women, I'm not talking about just men here, I wonder how many human lives have been devoured by a house. A house. Somehow, just the term house scares me. That's not the same as a home, a house. And I know guys with 30-year mortgages. Can you imagine putting down money and saying to somebody, in effect, I'm going to live here for 30 years? My God, the life expectancy of the human male in America today is around 69. That means you're, and when a guy is able to do this at the point when you're making a statement like that, you must be probably in your mid-20s or up through your mid-30s before you ever would say a thing like that. No guy at the age of 5 is going to buy a 30-year mortgage. You're in effect saying, this is where I'm going to be the rest of my life. That would scare the daylights out of me. Now, on the other hand, I think there are people who want that. And in short, I say that today you have two kinds of men. Yeah, because you always did have. And the conflict has always raged between them, the nesters and the movers. And there are people who, from the time they're 5, are looking for a nest to curl up in and stay there. And, you know, they want this nest. They're driven by the nest. Now, they're going to people that nest. you know, just like you people the West. They're going to people the nest. And that's why you hear so many guys talk more about their property, their yard, their automatic sprinkler system, their lawnmower, how quick it starts and has dual carburation now. I know one guy that has a lawnmower, it's roughly the size of a Winnebago. Has a bar in it, stereo and a whole bit, color TV. And he drives around white wall tires and the whole business. And they talk more about this stuff than they do say about their wife. Can you imagine Romeo dropping by Sears to buy a new lawnmower? And back home, Juliet is she's a member of the PTA now. She spends all her time driving back and forth in the station wagon and taking the kids to the Little League and the Cub Scouts and Romeo. You know, you never see the second act. You never see really the play. The real play is the play that occurred after Romeo married Juliet and about 10 years later, you know. And he's sitting in this bar in Verona and... he he's sitting there laughing it up. See, and in comes Clytemnestes or somebody. He says, "What's the matter, Romeo? What's the matter, Paisan?" And he looks up and he says, "Oh," he says, "it's what is it? Same thing." He says, "What is it?" He says, "Juliet again. She's on my neck again." Well, now this may sound like a sardonic, cynical show here, but it happens to be also very true that many guys, I was going to say, I go out to the suburbs the other night, my yearly foray into that strange world there, and a lot of stuff comes to light, and all these guys in this one room alone. This is in the affluent suburbs. I would say among the 75 people who were there, there was a minimum of $800 worth of tailored Levi slacks alone. You know, studied casualness. And yes, it was all there, everything. They even had a symbolic black there. It was fascinating. It was almost like out of one of the beer commercials. It was really fascinating. and so he and I are standing in the corner talking away, see, about the inner city. See, he says, where I live. And he lived out in the suburbs. He kept talking about, you know, we know about, he didn't know about the inner city. This guy lived out there, too. You know, he had a $5,000 lawnmower himself. So we're standing around there, and one of the guys comes over, see, and he's sort of looking he's got a kind of a pensive look. All the other guys are lapping up martinis and yelling and hollering, eating the peanuts and the macadamia nuts. The only place you find macadamia nuts is in very elegant suburban parties and on TWA. I think TWA designed that nut. I never saw them before I started to fly airplanes. Did you? Or don't you fly that much? Well, you know all about macadamia nuts. Yes, and smokehouse salted almonds. That's American Airlines. You get that all the time on them. Yeah. So, nevertheless, you know, I'm an aficionado of all this. I know the only airline in the country where when you order a drink, you know, you order bourbon, you don't get Old Granddad. You get Maker's Mark. How's that for an esoteric bourbon? I told him that. I says, you know, that's your real taste. Esoterica. I says, the next thing you know, it's going to be George Dickel here. Or maybe we're going to get one of the real elegant Tennessee bourbons. The next thing you know, I'm going to give up walking. I'm going to do nothing but flying around, you know. But nevertheless, you like this kind of al fresco show where it's all hung out, you know. It's out in the open, right? That's al fresco. Yes, al pesco is when we get one of these memos, you know. That's one of them pesky memos. You know what al pesco means? No, well, it doesn't matter. Just suffice it to say it comes with a slight cheese sauce on it and is fattening. But nevertheless, this guy walks into the crowd and he says, with a note of triumph in his voice, well, he said, of course, you know, in the middle of the conversation, he just dropped this little thing. So, of course, you know, you realize, of course, that I've left Gladys, you know, and I said, oh, yeah, really? I didn't know him. I never met him before, but you know, it was kind of nice to know he left Gladys. And he talked about this at great length, about leaving Gladys. And a couple hours later, see, I'm with another guy, and he says to me, he says, well, it's no wonder. He said, you know, I said, how long have you been married? He said, oh, 25 years. I said, what? Are you kidding? Said, yeah. He said, hated each other every minute. Fantastic. They'd fly each other with tooth and nail. I said, you mean 25 years and now he's ready to leave Gladys? He says, boy, was she ever glad when he left. And I says, well, gee, I'm kind of glad they finally did it, you know. And he said, yeah, they sure did. I got to congratulate old Murph. And the name has been changed to, as you probably know. And so, nevertheless, I thought about this. I thought to myself, blasted lives. Hopes and dreams down the drain. I'm not recommending you don't make any involvement. I'm recommending you be more careful. That's all. And also, you must take that beer commercial to heart, friends. You only go around once. You know, that's it. And you ought to say to yourself, you know, is this the way I want to live the rest of my existence? Well, of course, if everybody actually asked that question, can you imagine what would happen? Can you imagine the headlines? I mean, can't you just see, let's say,
local news, Jim Jensen comes on, and he says, an amazing thing happened today in Manhattan. There were 6,957,245 resignations today. Over three-quarters of the city resigned its job. So the hell with this and ran out. Do you really want to spend your entire life? You know, like the other day, somebody sent me a company magazine. You know, you see some fantastic things in company magazines. And here's this very proud-looking lady. Now, it's going to sound like I invented this. It's a very proud-looking lady. You ever look in company magazines? They have the bowling news, and they have the news of the annual banquet when Mr. Bullard gets his watch. They have a you've seen those company magazines. They're really great. And here was a page of pictures of people, see, who had gotten their 25-year last month. It's a big company, see. And here was this very proud-looking lady, and her hair was all done up. You know, there's a certain kind of lady, when she gets her picture done, she goes to the hairdresser and gets her hair all made up in these little round barrels. You know, so kind of curious-looking hairdo. And she's looking very, very proud out of this picture. And underneath it, it says, Mrs. C.L. Witherspoon, 25 years, last month, celebrated her 25th anniversary as the leading gizzard inspector in the company. She inspects gizzards. I'm serious. Now, a gizzard, now, you think I'm inventing this? 25 years looking inside a chicken's guts. Now, there's dedication. It's either that or it's madness. I can't tell which. Do we have a chicken spot, please?
Hey, what do you got for lunch today, Bill?
Ham sandwich. What do you got?
Meatloaf.
Flavor fried chicken is delicious!
Fred again? What's with him anyway?
Flavor fried chicken is juicy!
Yeah, Fred does that every time his wife puts Weaver fried chicken in his lunch. Today he must have batter dipped. He had Dutch fry the last time.
What's the difference?
Weaver fried chicken is crispy!
Weaver Dutch fry has a really crispy, crunchy breading, and Weaver batter dipped is coated with a sweet pancake-type batter.
My wife says it's easy to fix!
Hey, Hank, yeah. While Fred's running around yellow, let's go see if there's any Weaver chicken left in his lunch pail.
Hey, good idea.
Look, two pieces. Let's try it.
Hey, Weaver fried chicken is delicious!
It's crispy!
It's juicy!
Fred's wife says it's easy to fix!
Weaver, so great you'll have to tell someone.
Oh, yeah, that's exciting. While you're on the subject of commercials, Jim, I don't know why I'm saying all this, but anyway, you know, I was thinking about that. I was driving along, I was thinking about this, you know, that of course, circumstances of people's lives, this is why we have a literature. This is what literature is about, you know. But it never does anything. There's no way you can get out of any known book, and please don't send any tracks to me, please. There's no way you can get out of any novel, any handbook, anything that is at all relevant to the day-by-day life that you live. There's just no way. And the sad fact of it is that most people, and I think, you know, getting back to the whole idea of juvenocracy, I think most people, so many people in this country, I wonder what it's going to be like. I'll bet by the year 2000, I'm making a prediction, that not everybody will live to see, but I think by the year 2000, this is beginning to change, you know. By the year 2000, I suspect that a person of today, if he were to come back 2000, in the year 2000, that's about 26 years, and that's not the long, it's about 26 years from now, would hardly recognize the social structure of the daily lives of the people of that period. And a lot of our buildings are based on a past social structure. I'm talking about the business. Do you know that in certain parts of the country right now, already they're feeling that? They've built giant schools. Again, this is a part of the juvenocracy. They've built an enormous school with a fantastic gym and a tremendous auditorium. I know one school out in Pennsylvania that's got an auditorium alone. It's a high school that makes anything on a Broadway stage look like kid stuff. I mean, they have a fantastic auditorium, a whole big gym, and oh boy, it's controlled atmosphere and everything else going for it. And there are less and less kids being born there.
and the school population is dropping off rapidly. And that means that by the year maybe 2500, these school buildings will be almost museums. I said, yeah, that was back in the days when people had seven kids and stuff like that. People said, you mean they did that? You mean they just went out and without any, just indiscriminately had kids? Oh, yes, it was considered, believe it or not, a great virtue to have many children back in those days. And I'm going to say, a virtue? Are you kidding? Yes, it was. Great virtue. And it will be inexplicable to the people of that time. I am predicting this. In fact, they may even just arrest somebody once in a while for having a kid without a license. Now, what? You think that's funny? Some countries are getting to that already. In fact, America's fighting it tooth and nail, but other countries are really beginning to make moves in that direction to do something about curbing the population. But when you... and this is interpreted, incidentally, by many people. You're anti-life if you don't want to have 50 kids. But actually, I don't buy that at all. In some ways, I think it's almost anti-life to have that many. And you're going to find an argument going on that score. But it is sad to me, though, to find so many people all of a sudden arrive at a certain point in their life, and everything they plan in their life is always in the future. And this is the chanciest thing of anybody's existence, the future. And yet, more people than I, you know, care to admit to knowing, are planning all these fantastic things in the future. And you know, this is always a big thing in their head. One day I'm going to, ... The saddest words of pen or man. One day I'm going to. And, of course, then you have, again, the basic split between the movers and the nesters. I must admit, I'm a mover. I can't, I'm making no value judgments, because the world has to be of both. No value judgments at all. But a nester gets kind of vaguely nervous when in the presence of a mover. As if you're some kind of a kook. You know, what do you mean? You don't have a place with a lawn and the hedges and the bushes and the things out there and the fountain squirting up in the water there? Just think, if you move down here, you could have a swimming pool. I said, oh, no. Please. No. On the other hand, there's some of that in both of us. You know, one of the saddest things is to see a nester married to a mover. Oh, that's murder. That is murder. And it can be either a male or a female. I mean, there are many nesters that are men. You know, just have you ever driven up into places like Vermont and the local natives will point out something on the hill? They'll say, look up there. And you look up there and say, what the hell is that? And you see this strange, enormous, misshapen house, and they'll say, oh, that's a Kluberman's Folly. What do you mean, Kluberman's Folly? Well, Kluberman built on that house for over 75 years. He kept building new rooms on it, and he kept adding new additions to it, and he put out placebos, and isn't that a placebo, a little place where you had to swing, right, a placebo? Sure, of course. And he had all these things going there, see? And then the day he died, the carpenters arrived for the next big move. Kluberman's Folly. That's a nester. The bigger, the more solid, the more enormous the nest, the more secure he feels. Yep, we all have a secret admiration for gypsies. I mean, your entire existence is on wheels. Starts raining, you move. People start saying bad things in the neighborhood, you move. You see a cigar butt laying on the street you don't like, you move. Just keep rolling and looking at all and digging it. Digging it.
Someday you'll own. Someday you'll own.
This is a special spot here for movers. Entire life is on wheels. And whether you drive a sports car, a sedan, or you just have little wheels on your feet, General Tire has the wheels and the tires you need at prices you can afford. Steel-belted radial tires, glass-belted original equipment tires. They're all beautiful tires. And don't come along and tell me that if God had wanted you to have generals, you'd have come with a lifelong guarantee and a set of white walls on your feet. It's a little more complicated than that, friends. See your General Tire dealer in Hackensack. Larry Levy at General Tire Service, and sing it out. Clear and simple. Let them know where you stand.
Sooner or later, you'll own generals.
Yeah.
Sooner or later, you'll own the generals.
I think you're always impressed by my timing, aren't you? Jim can tell you there ain't nobody better in the business with the timing, right? It's instinctual. When you're a mover, you better have good timing. You gotta know when to leave, man. They're gonna throw the net over you if you don't watch out. It's quick. You know, that reminds me, you know, speaking of the curious mores of our world, which are curiouser and curiouser, you know, if you think that the Orient, you remember the old expression, the inscrutable East? Well, when you've heard that expression, the inscrutable East, right? Well, when you go out to the inscrutable East, they have an expression there which is roughly translated the totally inscrutable West. That's right. They really do. Did you know that? They have the equivalent. They can't understand. Our strange mores. It would never occur to a man of the Orient, for example, to base his entire life on where the kids want to live. That would be inscrutable. And it is inscrutable when some guy, you know, arrives from Darien. Well, I live out there because the kids like it, you know, and they have a good little league team. And he goes on and on, see. Well, I think a lot of guys secretly want to keep their base of operations as far away from their real base of operations as possible. You know, a little hanky-panky down on 23rd Street. Who wants that to be so close to Darien that it could rub together and cause explosions? You don't need that either, right, Jim? No, you're not guilty of any of that stuff. Of course not. I'm sorry to hear that, but that's true, you're not. You know, speaking of mores, the other night, we just mentioned casually, there's a guy down in Montgomery. Only in America would a guy get fined for cursing at stray dogs. Now, that's right, Montgomery, Alabama. Dexter Jernigan, ain't that a great name? That's like a C&W singer that don't stop. Dexter Jernigan. Old Dexter Jernigan. Come on, you know, singing a Red River Valley. Anyway, Dexter Jernigan has been fined $25 for just cursing a stray dog. And you know why he did it? He says, you can't even go out in the yard without stepping on something, Jernigan said. Well, Jernigan's neighbor, Flora Stroud, doesn't she sound like a nice lady? Can you imagine Flora Stroud? Said she went outside in her, you know, out in her yard, and Jernigan came out, quote, well, he came out raising Cain about the dogs and just cussing at those poor little puppies. I can see poor old Dexter. Oh, my God, get out of there. Look at that, all over my new shoes. Get out of here, you mutt. Next thing you know, it's $25. Only in America. Now, you try to explain that to the Chinese. They would say, what the, oh, so what, men make a vicious word on the stray dog, and he receive a $25 fine? Very interesting. For what? It's, well, you know, he said bad things to dogs. But was he in his own yard at the time? Of course he was, Mr. Yen, he was in his own yard, but after all, he did say bad things about dogs, and we're living in an Alpo society. All you have to do is watch television. You know that the dogs eat better than the people. Oh, so yes, sir. Again, another example of inscrutable West. East is East and West is West, we always say, in Taipei. And it's, well... Now, you know, what are you going to do? It's just the way it is. You have to accept life for what it is, right, Jim? No, you don't. Wait. Stop right there. Did you hear what I just said? I said you have to accept life for what it is. That is not true. And that's the whole point of this show tonight. You do not have to accept life for what it is. You have made what it is, you lout, you knave. God did not say to you, thou shalt buy a $700 automatic electrical-driven lawnmower, or thou shalt be a sinner in the eyes of thy neighbors. No, you just did it yourself.
God did not say, thou shalt live in Darien and forever be in peace and desperation, because thou hast 18 children and thou is looking for a good school for thy children's. Thou go now. No, he hasn't said that. You said it. Yeah, well, that concludes tonight's salute to McDonald's. Do we have time for the Sardis?
Sardi's Restaurant would like to introduce you to their special Club Sardi Dinner, $6.95 plus tax, served nightly from 4:30 p.m. to midnight except Sunday. Club Sardi's has tempting entrees, including their famous cannelloni and delicious supreme of chicken sardi. Start with a choice of appetizer, end with a selection of Sardi's desserts. Reservations are suggested. Please mention Club Sardi when calling. The number is 524-0707. That's Sardi's at 234 West 44th Street.
And once more the horn blows at midnight and calls to thee and thee and thee, and the bell ringeth out clear and brilliant in the ambient air.
That's kind of nice, isn't it? I
bet not one of you can tell me who I'm quoting. All right, you dumb nut. I'm quoting me. Okay, bring it up. You dummy. Who am I quoting when I say that, you dummy? Red Fox. Hi, Jim. Hello, Jim, you dummy. Hi. Join the rest of us, Jim, huh? Join the rest of us dummies sitting around in here. What's it all about? Have you ever wondered, you know? You don't wonder, huh? You just sit in the back seat of the Pontiac and eat French fries, right? That's right. A little ripple now and again, a little Thunderbird, maybe, yeah. Oh, well, all right. Makes you cough. I know a guy that pours Thunderbird over butterscotch ice cream. He says it's fantastic. And another guy that puts vodka in a strawberry Yoo-Hoo. Oh, man. Orphan Annie's downfall.